أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم والذين إذا أصابهم البغي هم ينتصرون وجزاء سيئة سيئة مثلها فمن عفا وأصلح فأجره على الله إنه لا يحب الظالمين ولمن انتصر بعد ظلمه فأولئك ما عليهم من سبيل إنما السبيل على الذين يظلمون الناس ويبغون في الأرض بغير الحق أولئك لهم عذاب أليم ولمن صبر وغفر إن ذلك لمن عزم الأمور رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله ثم أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته InshaAllah ta'ala, today we're comparing the two concepts that I was referring to yesterday, the concept of justice versus the concept of forgiveness. We're going to look at one passage from Surah Ash-Shura briefly, and then turn to one ayah from Surah An-Nur to complete the subject, inshaAllah. So we begin, and I'm describing this, actually, I'm beginning from the middle of a passage. This passage, from the top of it, Allah Azza wa Jalla is describing the people who earn His paradise, and part of it is this section. He says, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَهُمُ الْبَغْيِ هُمْ يَنْتَصِرُونَ These are the people when rebellion afflicts them, meaning some people rebel against them, then they avenge themselves, they help themselves. They don't just take it sitting down, they stand up and they seek justice, in other words. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَجَزَاءُ سَيِّئَةٍ سَيِّئَةٌ مِثْلُهَا And the payback of an evil deed, the payback of something bad, is something bad of the equal measure. Meaning if somebody does something bad to you, justice would be what? The payback is what? Something you do back to them in equal amount. Now we have to pause here for a second because you could obviously sense these are the ayat about justice. We said there are going to be two concepts today, justice and forgiveness. These are obviously the ayat that are dealing with justice. But we have to think about this in a very practical way. Allah Azza wa Jal is clearly saying the payback of something bad is something bad just like it. جَزَاءُ سَيِّئَةٌ سَيِّئَةٌ مِثْلُهَا But, in real life, if somebody harms you, for example, somebody insults you, or somebody accuses you, or somebody physically pushes you, or something like that, then you say, well, justice is I want to do that exact same thing to them. But you know, human nature, our anger comes over. So we're not doing it for the sense of justice, we're doing it out of revenge, right? It's not really for justice, it's more for revenge. And when you have revenge in your heart, then what happens? Do you take equal amount or do you take a little extra more? You have a chance of taking a little extra more, right? So here you are, you're saying, I have the right to do this, but because in the back of your intentions isn't justice, it's revenge, there's a chance, a good chance that you're going to go overboard. And this is what the scholars warn against, that the people who seek justice, very few of them are actually muqtasid, that they're actually fair. But most of them, when they seek justice, they end up becoming unjust. It's a very, very fine line. And some scholars even added more. They said if somebody pushed you, and you pushed them back, do you know for sure that your push hurt them the same amount as it hurt you? Or maybe they're weaker, and when you push them, it hurt them more, and when they pushed you, it hurt you less. You follow? So justice is very difficult, especially in dunya. Justice is extremely difficult. Real justice, perfect justice is executed on the day of judgment. Until then, we have this makeshift justice, right? So nonetheless, Allah Azza wa Jalla gave the principle, the reward of a good deed is good, or the payback of an evil is an evil just like it. Now one more thing. The scholars commented about the comparison between justice and forgiveness in this world. If you seek justice against the person who harmed you, then what's the most you will get? Probably the most you will get is temporary satisfaction. But if they have caused you harm, that harm cannot be taken back. Like if somebody insulted you, and you insulted them back, for example, then the fact that your feelings were hurt is not going to go away, right? Even if you take justice, even if you take revenge, that feeling will still be there. That scar has already been made. But if you forgive, then you are at a higher level. That not only will that scar be erased from Allah Azza wa Jal, but you're at this higher state. You've been honored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when they compare justice and forgiveness, they said both are permissible, but one is certainly a higher principle, right? Now Allah Azza wa Jal says in the same ayah, فَمَنْ عَفَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Allah is comparing the jaza, the ajr, of two things. If you harmed me for $100, then justice would be, what should I get back? $100. But Allah says, whoever lovingly forgave and reconciled the matter. Islah is something we talked about yesterday. فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. So Allah says, whoever took the option instead of seeking justice of reconciling. Then He says, فَأَجْرُهُ, then His reward is going to be عَلَى اللَّهِ, on Allah. Meaning when it comes to seeking revenge, Allah quantifies how much you can get. Only what was taken from you, that's what you can get. When you forgive, you get so much that Allah doesn't even quantify it. He says it's on Him. So imagine the volume of the blessings and the favor and the ajr that Allah will give, that He doesn't even put a quantity on. He doesn't say it's Jannah. He doesn't say it's, you know, gardens in paradise or this or that or the other. Nothing. He says, عَلَى اللَّهِ. It's on Allah. So imagine the comparison between the two. And then He says, إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الظَّالِمِينَ. Without a doubt, He doesn't love the wrongdoing. Those who do ظلم, those who fall under, you know, cruelty or unjust behavior. Why is this important to mention at the end? You have two options in dunya. You can seek revenge or you can forgive. And when you seek revenge, what are good chances? You might become ظالم. So how does He end the ayah? إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الظَّالِمِينَ. وَلَمَنْ انْتَصَرَ بَعْدَ ظُلْمِهِ. But then there's the other extreme opposite scenario. You know, we're not Christian. To the Christian, forgiveness is at the forefront and justice, forget it. It's almost an evil deed. So if somebody wants justice, the Christian will tell him, don't do that, that's not from God. God wants love and forgiveness, right? But if a Muslim wants justice, he wants justice, the other Muslim cannot come to him and say, you have no right to do this, this is sinful. Because the two options that Allah gave, either the seeking of revenge from in a just fashion or forgiveness, are they both not from Allah? They're both from Allah. So whoever seeks to avenge after he was wronged, وَلَمَنْ انْتَصَرَ بَعْدَ ظُلْمِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَا عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ سَبِيلٍ. Then these are people, there's no case to be made against them. You can't make any case against them and say, why did this person pursue justice? It's his fault. He shouldn't have done that. No. That's also from Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's also permissible. He's not blameworthy if he does so. But then he adds, إِنَّمَا السَّبِيلَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ يَظْلِمُونَ النَّاسِ. Rather, if you want to blame someone, blame the one who wronged people. The only case that can be made is against the people who wronged others. وَيَبْغُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. And they rebel in the land without any right to do so. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. They are the ones that have painful punishment. And then he adds this one ayah that I want to actually begin this talk of forgiveness with. وَلَمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ. فَإِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. He says, as for the one who has sabr and he forgave. You all know the meaning of sabr. Perseverance, holding your emotions, restraining yourself, and after that forgiving, covering the other's fault. Allah says that this is from the most noble of deeds. And the way he ends the ayah, listen carefully, he says, إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. Now let me share another ayah with you, which ends in a similar way. Luqman radiallahu anhu is giving advice to his son. And he tells him, وَصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ. وَصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ. إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. Let me read this ayah to you again. This ayah ends, إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. And when Luqman was speaking to his son, that ayah ends, إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. Is there a difference? Once again, listen carefully. إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. What's the difference? Did you hear a difference? The lam. Right? There's a difference. It's a subtle difference. Now when Luqman was talking to his son, radiallahu anhu, what did he say? He said, have sabr over anything that happens to you. Any calamity that happens to you, have sabr. Because this is from the most noble of deeds. And the way to say these are from the most noble of deeds, the highest caliber of deeds, إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. In these ayat, Allah says, وَلَمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ. Whoever has sabr. Now Luqman was talking about sabr too, right? But he didn't talk about forgiveness. In this ayat, there's also Yeah, there's sabr and there's maghfirah. وَلَمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. Now Islam, what it does is it makes this ayah a little higher. The status of this action higher than the status of the ayah in which sabr was mentioned. And there's another thing. You know, there are two kinds of sabr. And it's very important to understand. There are two kinds of sabr, basically. There's sabr over an earthquake, and there's sabr over a flood, and there's sabr over a car accident, or there's sabr over a sickness. There's sabr over situations where you have no control over the situation. If it happened to you, you have to deal with it. There's sabr over the loss of a family member, right? These are situations in which you can do nothing but have sabr. You can either cry about it or become emotionally, you know, unstable, or have sabr. So what is the better option? Sabr. When Luqman was telling his son, he was telling him about any calamity that happens to him. When calamities happen to you, do you have control over them? No. So he says, وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ إِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. But in these ayat that we just talked about in Surah Ash-Shura, we're talking about the person who can take revenge. Somebody has harmed you and you can take revenge. This is different from an earthquake or a flood or a sickness, because now can you do something more than sabr? Can you take revenge too? You can, right? You can't take revenge against a mountain. You can't take revenge against the earth or against the sky for sending a flood or against the wind for a typhoon. You can't do that. But for a person that harms you, you can take revenge. But even then, even though when you have the option to take revenge, you still have sabr, which is harder. It's much harder to do that. And you still have sabr, and despite the fact that there's anger inside you, you still forgive. This is a higher caliber of sabr. Right? You can see the obvious difference between them. And so how does Allah end the ayah? إِنَّ ذَلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. He gives this kind of sabr a higher caliber. Now the final thing about this, when you know, we talk about forgiving each other and moving along, you say to each other, yeah, well, Brother Nouman, you know, you don't know what this guy did to me. You don't know what I've been through. You don't understand. This guy is evil. You know, he deserves it. He doesn't deserve forgiveness. And let me ask you this. When somebody is to be forgiven, obviously they don't deserve it. They deserve punishment. That's when you need forgiveness, right? So if you're telling me this person doesn't deserve it, no, I know what you're talking about. I know this is in Qur'an and everything, but this guy, he's different. This doesn't apply here. This is a special situation. And wallahi, everybody thinks they have a special situation. And nobody thinks the ayat apply on them. You know, when the situation comes to you, say, I know this is what Allah says. I know there's a hadith like this. I know there's an ayah like this. But my situation, it's a unique exception to this rule. Right? So inshallah, I'll apply this ayah next time, when it's easier. And so we compare this sentiment. First of all, if you take revenge, what's the most you will get? Revenge. If you forgive, what will you get? Something that Allah doesn't even give a quantity to. فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Imagine that. But then the second incentive. You know, whatever the other person did to you, I can hardly imagine it would hurt you more in dunya than what hurt our leader, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, when his daughter was accused. And his daughter is not just a daughter. She is the dignity, not of his family, but she's also the dignity of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and thereby she is the dignity of the entire ummah. Our mother, she is the dignity of the entire ummah. So when she was accused, the worst kind of accusation, she was accused of a shameless act in public, and the scandal is spreading across to the point where the messenger is under depression, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's not even talking to her. And she is just in complete despair, right? In this situation, one of the people who started this scandal was actually a person, many of you know, who used to be given allowance by Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was a wealthy man, and he used to give some people some monthly or weekly allowance, so they could get by their weekly expenses, their home expenses. One of the people who accused his daughter was a person who used to get charity from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Now look at the mercy of this man. If somebody accuses my daughter, the first thing I want to do is kill him. That's the first thing I want to do. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, even in his angry state, the most he decides to do is he's not going to give him money anymore. That's not even a punishment. Right? Look at the mercy of this man, radiallahu anhu. Nonetheless, because he's of a higher caliber, He's at a higher level. You know, the ulama used to say that the good deeds of the low people are comparable to the bad deeds of the noble people, the people that are close to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Like, I'll give you a comparison, you know. One of us, we don't come for salah usually. Okay? One day we make it for salah. And we feel like we have won some kind of trophy. And we, you know, we feel this pride. Man, I made salah in the masjid today. On time too. You know? And there's, in that same masjid, in that same community, there's a person who's in the salah every single day in the first row. And today they got there so that they got at the end of the first row or they got the second row. This person's thinking, I missed out today. Same salah, right? One person's thinking, I've accomplished this amazing standard. And the other's thinking, what? I messed up today. Different caliber. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is at a different caliber. And Allah Azza wa Jalla reveals this ayah, very profound ayah. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in Surah An-Nur, وَلَا يَأْتَلِ أُولُو الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ وَالسَّعَةِ. Now, يَأْتَلْ, this إِتِلَى is a very interesting word. It means to, one meaning of it is health, meaning to take an oath. Don't let these people take an oath. Allah is going to talk about that, I'll explain inshaAllah ta'ala. Another meaning of itila is actually to lose momentum, to kind of lose enthusiasm. You know, you want to do something, but you don't feel like doing it much anymore. Something's happened that's kind of turned you off. And the word for that is itila. So he says, وَلَا يَأْتَلِ أُولُو الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ. Don't let the people who have fadl, meaning Allah has given them a lot of halal rizq from among you, وَسَعَى, and financial means, أَنْ يُؤْتُوا أُولِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَالْمُهَاجِرِينَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, that they should stop giving. Don't let them lose any, you know, enthusiasm, that it should, they should stop giving to who? The people that are close in family, the poor, those who have migrated for the sake of Allah. They should actually keep giving. They shouldn't lose heart. Now look, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he wants to give sadaqah still, but this person's accused his daughter. He's accused the wife of the beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we love the Messenger, but we can't compare this love to the love of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. How much pain he's going through. So he, even if he wants to give, there's something in his heart that says, I can't give this person. And Allah says, don't let your giving slow down. Keep giving. And then he gives Abu Bakr as-Siddiq one little piece of incentive in this ayah. One incentive. One line. And because of this one line, it's enough for Abu Bakr to forgive. Radiallahu anhu. So what did Allah tell Abu Bakr as-Siddiq? That he could overcome his anger. Whatever he told him weighs more than the anger and the sadness of Abu Bakr. So what is it? He says to him, وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا. They should forgive lovingly. And they should completely overlook this issue. Meaning when you forgive someone, you don't bring it up again. And you put it in your heart that almost like it did, it never happened. It's not in the back of your mind even that this person did such a thing. They should reach that level. وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا. And then Allah tells him why. How can you reach that status? أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Wouldn't you love that Allah would forgive you? What Allah tells him is, wouldn't you love that Allah would forgive you? So now Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and through him all of us, are presented with an option. We can take the revenge because we're angry. Or Allah says, if you forgive, then I'm offering you something. What is Allah offering us? Our forgiveness. So you have to weigh two things. You have two sides of the scale. On one side of this scale is your anger, and on the other side is how badly do you want Allah to forgive you. Right? There are two things you have to weigh. How angry are you, and how badly do you want to be forgiven? And when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was given this option, what did he choose? He chose forgiveness. Right? So when the next time you think about justice, even though it's permissible in Allah's name, and what the Messenger was doing, and actually Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was doing, was completely fine. It wasn't haram of him to do so. But Allah gave him this better alternative, this better option. So now think about that. But, you know, especially in this month, when shaitan doesn't come and knocking on our ear every time and get us waswasah to get angry and not take the option of forgiving. If you owe somebody an apology, give them that apology in this month. Don't let it go by before you, you know, let them hear your apology. Because even then the shaitan can put nazar between you, right? So take that opportunity. And if somebody, you know, you have to forgive someone, then take the opportunity to forgive them. Don't let this month go by without you earning Allah's forgiveness. And the easiest way to do so is to forgive somebody else. فَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Now, a couple quick comments here, because I'll end at 11 sharp, inshallah ta'ala. One comment, this kind of anger and frustration doesn't happen between distant friends. And it doesn't happen between work associates. Mostly this happens with very close people to you. These kinds of very horrible kinds of fights, they happen between family. They happen between cousins, between brothers, between business partners, close friends, right? This is where it happens. It doesn't happen. If you don't know people very well, it's not very easy to get extremely angry at them because you just don't know them. So these conflicts occur within the family. And within the family, it's much harder to make up, to forgive, because you're constantly seeing the person. You know, this sort of thing happens a lot between husband and wife, for example. In contemporary society, this sort of thing happens a lot between father and son. Son gets older, he wants, you know, total freedom, he doesn't want anything to do with the father, and the father says, why aren't you home more, and this and that, and one day it just explodes in the house, and they don't talk to each other. Muslim families, father hasn't spoken to son hasn't spoken to father in 2-3 years. It's terrible. It's completely unacceptable in our deen, but it happens. But now Allah is giving us this alternative, right? Beyond the fact that you have to keep relations with your family, beyond that, even above and beyond that, we have to mend these ties. Because we love that Allah Azza wa Jalla will forgive all of us. This is the incentive with which we go forward. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us a people that, you know, seek to forgive one another, inshallah ta'ala. Take every opportunity to do so. Think and reflect on yourself. Maybe you said something, you were just kidding, you didn't realize that the other person's feelings were hurt. You didn't think so, but there's a chance they were hurt. Don't take that chance, because they might stand up on the Day of Judgment and tell you. You know? And I'll conclude with this. A week ago, one of my good friends from Louisiana, his mother passed away. Very young man. And his mother, she had cancer before, and then alhamdulillah, that was cleared. And then 2 weeks ago, she got the news again that the cancer has come up again. And when she got the news, she was very happy. And she kept telling her son, I'm very proud of you. I'm very proud of you. I have nothing, I don't anger with you whatsoever. And just take care of your life. She's constantly giving him good advice, telling him that there's nothing wrong between her and him. And all he can think about as he's hearing her, he can't even listen to her. He says, Mom, stop talking. You're scaring me, right? All he's thinking about is when he was younger, when he was a teen, when he was a kid. You know, sometimes you yell at your mother. Sometimes you lash out at her. And he can't stop thinking about those times. And she constantly reassures him, I have nothing against you. I have nothing against you. I've forgiven you for everything. Right, don't think that I'm angry with you. I'm very proud of you. You're a great son. All of this stuff, over and over again. And she passes away, rahmahullah. And when she passed away, when I talked to him, I actually talked to him today, and you know what he said to me? He said, my mother gave me the greatest gift by telling me she's forgiven me. Because on the Day of Judgment, the close we are right now, is that going to be the closeness on the Day of Judgment? No. On the Day of Judgment, you will be concerned with herself, and I will be concerned with myself. And if she had not forgiven me here, and she went on the Day of Judgment, would she have forgiven me then? No, because she needs the good deeds for herself. So this was a great mercy of my mother on me. So seek the forgiveness of the fellow Muslims. Seek the forgiveness especially of your parents and of family, inshallah ta'ala. And when you have the opportunity to forgive, don't lose that opportunity. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa fa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayat wa dhikr al-Hakim. Assalamu alaikum.